ఫ్రెండ్స్, వెల్కమ్ టు అవర్ యూట్యూబ్ ఛానల్ నాలెడ్జ్ అకాడమీ. ద మెయిన్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ లెక్చర్ డిస్కస్ అబౌట్ ద టీఎస్పీఎస్ జనరల్ స్టడీస్ ప్రీవియస్ ఇయర్ క్వశ్చన్స్ ఇన్ అ వెరీ వెరీ డీటెయిల్ మేనర్. అండ్ ఇఫ్ యూ లైక్ ద కంటెంట్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ ఛానల్ దెన్ ప్లీజ్ టు లైక్ షేర్ అండ్ సబ్స్క్రైబ్ అవర్ యూట్యూబ్ ఛానల్ అండ్ డోంట్ ఫర్గెట్ టు ప్రెస్ ద బెల్ ఐకాన్ బటన్. సో వెనెవర్ యూ అప్లోడ్ ఎ న్యూ వీడియో ద డైరెక్ట్ నోటిఫికేషన్ కమ్స్ టు యువర్ మొబైల్. ఇఫ్ ఎనీ ఇంప్రూవ్మెంట్స్ ఇన్ ఇన్ అవర్ లెక్చర్స్ దెన్ ప్లీజ్ టు కమెంట్ ద కమెంట్ సెక్షన్. వీ విల్ డెఫినెట్లీ ఇంక్లూడ్ ఆల్ దోస్ ఇంప్రూవ్మెంట్స్ ఇన్ ద కమింగ్ లెక్చర్స్. సో వై టు వేస్ట్ మోర్ టైమ్, సో లెట్స్ గెట్ స్టార్టెడ్. So now we are going to solve the 26th question. See the question here. The instrument that measures arterial pressure is known as option A, pyknometer, option B, hypsometer, option C, zygoscope, option D, spirometer. So out of the four options, option D, spirometer is the correct solution of this question. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. So now we'll discuss some of the important facts of the spirometer. Spirometer is also called as a blood pressure monitor, or it is also called as a blood pressure gauge. So here, this instrument was invented by the Samuel Siegfried Kahl and also the writer Von Bach. These are the two persons who have invented this spirometer in the 1881. In the 1881 year, these two persons have invented this one. So the main function of this is to measure the blood pressure or the arterial pressure. So blood pressure is also called as the arterial pressure. Suppose in the given, if the blood is going with high resistance, means there is some amount of cholesterol here. So because of this, their blood flow will be having a very high resistance. So because if the high resistance for a blood flow, we can say that person is going to have a high BP. Means high BP means high resistance to blood flow. So therefore, low BP means low resistance, means there is no cholesterol here. So therefore, the vessels are very, very clean. So therefore, the blood is going in a very easy manner. So therefore, the person is having no BP. But if a person has high BP, means the resistance to blood is very, very high because of some of the cholesterol which are attached to the blood vessels. So therefore, this spirometer instrument is like this. Here, there will be a small scale and there is a small tube. In this tube, there is a mercury. And also there is a rubber cuff. And also there is a rubber cuff here. The rubber cuff is going to attach to the human hand. This rubber cuff is attached to the human hand. So therefore, now with the help of this one, we can measure the amount of blood pressure in the human body. So here, this is the... So in the question they asked, which is the instrument which is going to measure the arterial pressure? Means arterial pressure means blood pressure is nothing but spirometer. So now we are going to solve the 27th question. See the question here. Which atomic clock is used as the standard of time in the world? Option A, rubidium clock. Option B, cesium clock. Option C, tantalum clock. Option D, molybdenum clock. So out of the four options, option B, cesium clock. Cesium is the atomic clock which is used as the standard of time in the world. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. Now we'll discuss some of the important facts of the cesium clock. So what is a cesium clock? Louis Essen and Jack Parry, these are the two people who have invented the world's first cesium atomic clock. So these are the two persons who have invented this cesium atomic clock. So the main function of the cesium clock is nothing but no matter wherever you take in the galaxy. So no matter wherever the galaxy you take, see here, the time is always fixed for this one. Because here the cesium atoms are going to have in the excited state. So in the excited state, if you are going to pass the radio waves, suppose for the cesium atoms, if you are going to pass the radio waves with a frequency of 9,192,631,770 cycles, if you pass any radio waves with this much amount of frequency, then these cesium atoms are going to go into the excited state. So therefore, if these atoms are going to go in excited state and they again come back to the normal state, and this time period is a constant one. It is a very constant in everywhere. So therefore, if you pass the radio waves with this frequency, these cesium atoms are going to excited state and also they come back to the normal state. And the time period for the electron to go into the highly state and come back to the normal state, the time period is a constant. So this transition is detected by a detector. So we will keep some detector in order to detect this transition. So then this detector is given to the pendulum. So therefore, one transition is going to make a one cycle. So that cycle is considered as a 1 second. So therefore, if it is going to make a one swing with this transition, then this one swing is said to be a 1 second. So therefore, this is called as a standard time. So based on this only, the time of the standard time definition is made. So therefore, if you take cesium atoms in anywhere in the galaxy, always the time period or the time is a very, very constant. Means for the transition, the time is a fixed one. So therefore, this is detected by a detector, and this detector is going to give to the pendulum. So therefore, this pendulum is going to make a one full cycle. Then one full cycle is nothing but a one second. So therefore, we are going to use only cesium atoms. The remaining atoms may have different variations depending upon the galaxy you are using, but this is going to have a fixed time period of transition. That is the reason the cesium atoms are preferred when compared to the remaining things. Now we are going to solve the 28th question. See the question here. In a night vision device, which one of the following types of waves are used? Option A, microwaves. Option B, ultraviolet rays. Option C, radio waves. And option D, infrared rays. So out of the four options, option D, infrared rays are used in the night vision devices. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. So now we'll discuss some of the important facts of the night vision device. So this is a rough black diagram of the night vision device. Suppose there is a person, suppose this is a criminal. So he's a criminal person, and this person is called as a military person, police officer, some police officer, military person. So in the night there is no light, right? So in the night there is no light, but this person, the any human body is going to emit the infrared rays. So because of the hot temperature, because if a person has a hot, means every person has some amount of temperature, so because of that temperature only the body is going to emit the infrared rays. So always remember one thing, the hotter objects are going to emit the infrared rays rather than the cold body, but human body itself has some amount of temperature, so therefore because of that reason only this person is going to emit the infrared rays. So these infrared rays are emitted, so in the night, so therefore in the night what is going to happen is these infrared rays are emitted by this human body, then these infrared rays are caught by this photocathode. This photocathode is nothing but it is like a solar panel. So these rays are detected by this photocathode, and then they are going to give output as electrical signal. This electrical signal is given to the amplifier, so therefore this amplifier is going to amplify this electrical signal, means more electrical amplified signal. Then this is given to another device, so this device is going to convert the electrical energy into light. So therefore this light is sensed by this police officer or the military person. So therefore now he can see this person as a clear green image. So therefore now he can see this person as a some clear green image. So all this is nothing but it is a some rough block diagram of that night vision device, and it is going to wear by this person like a spreads. So therefore now this person can see a clear green image of this person, so therefore he can easily cut this person. So therefore this is a rough block diagram of the night vision device, and this device is used in the it is used in the military, navigation, surveillance. So in these three places this night vision device is used. And also the basic fundamental property is here, the hotter objects are going to emit the infrared rays. So because of this reason only the person is going to have some amount of temperature. So this infrared rays are caught by this cathode, it is again amplified and it is converted into light. So therefore this person can easily view this person thief in a very clear green image. So therefore he can caught this person. This is the basic fundamental of the night vision device. So night vision device is going to use the fundamental, which is infrared rays. So now you are going to solve that 29th question. See the question here. If two papers are kept very close to each other and wind is blown in between them, they would. Option A, come closer. Option B, move apart. Option C, remain stationary. Option D, none of the above. So what are the four options? Option A, come closer. So if you keep two papers and if you blow some amount of air between these two papers, then these two papers are going to come closer. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. So now I am going to small experiment, which is here. I am going to place it two papers here. Then I am going to blow the air in the between them. So now what is going to happen? Then here, as the wind has going to have some amount of velocity. See, as the wind is, we are going to force the air in a very high speed manner. Means the velocity of the wind is very, very higher. So therefore the pressure of the wind is very will be less. So therefore this pressure and velocity are inversely proportional. So if the velocity of the wind is higher, means the pressure of the wind is very, very less. So outside pressure is very higher now. So outside this, the pressure is very, very higher when compared to the inside. So therefore there is a lot of force. When there is high pressure, means lot of force. So therefore these two papers are going to come close to each other, because here outside pressure is very, very higher than the inside pressure, because if the wind velocity is more, means the pressure of the wind will be very, very less. So therefore here outside air has higher pressure when compared to the inside air. So therefore we can conclude that these two papers are going to come closer to each other. So same principle is going to happen in the railway track also. Suppose there is a railway track, here train is going to come to the platform with a very, very high speed. So therefore if you are going to stand near to the track, so what is going to happen is same principle. So as the train is going to come very, very faster, so the air between the person and the train is very high. So therefore the pressure will be very less. So therefore, the outside pressure is very, very higher. So therefore, this person is going to struck to the train and then he is going to be crushed by the train. That is the reason, never stand beside the track. So therefore, you have to move somewhat far than the track. So therefore, you will be able to save yourself from the crashing. So now you are going to solve the last question of this lecture. See the question here. The power of a tractor is generally measured in the following units. Option A, horsepower. Option B, kilowatts. Option C, joules. Option D, FPS. So what are the four options? Option A, horsepower. So horsepower is the general unit which you are going to use for the tractors. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. So now we'll discuss some of the important facts of this horsepower. Generally the tractors are going to measure in terms of the horsepower, which is from 16 HP to 500 HP. So the smallest tractor which available presently is 16 horsepower, and the largest tractor which is presented now, it is 500 HP. So generally 1 HP is nothing but 746 watts. So the what is the meaning of the horsepower? Means, suppose there is a horse here, suppose this is a horse. So now there is a wheel here. So you are going to tie this some mass object to this horse. So therefore this horse is going to move here in this direction. So therefore the mass is going to move in the upward direction. The mass of the body is here 250 kg, or in the terms of pounds it is 550 pounds. So if you are going to, suppose this horse is moving in this direction, so therefore this mass is going to move upward direction. Suppose this horse is moving in such a way, so therefore if the mass is moved by 1 foot, so if the mass is just moved by 1 foot up, the distance moved by this mass is, if it is 1 foot, then 1 HP is nothing but 550 pounds mass into the amount of distance which is moved, which is 1 foot. So 1 HP is nothing but 550 pounds into 1 foot. So this much amount of work, the amount of work which is done by horse in order to move a mass of 550 pounds to a distance of 1 foot, that is called as a 1 horsepower. So the amount of work which is done by the horse in order to move a mass of 550 pounds to a distance of 1 foot, that much amount of work is called as a 1 horsepower. So therefore this horsepower, the term the horsepower, it was firstly which is used in the 18th century. This term was firstly, it was used in the 18th century by the Scottish engineer. The engineer name is James Watt. He is the person who invented the steam engine. So by using this term only, he calculated the output of his steam engine. Because he is the inventor of the steam engine, so by using this horsepower unit only, he has calculated the output of his steam engine. So horsepower is nothing but it is going to use the power of the horse. So finally, I can conclude that the tractors we are going to use, the power, the unit of power which are going to use for the tractors is HP. The smallest tractor available presently, which is 16 HP, and the highest tractor which is now available is 500 HP.
So by this lecture, we have successfully completed the 30 questions of the episode 3 in a very, very detailed manner of the TSPS General Studies questions. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button. So whenever you upload a new video, the direct notice comes to mobile. If any improvements here in our lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Keep smiling, take care and bye-bye.